If you clicked on this video, then you must have just watched Perfect Blue, and you're probably thinking to yourself, wow, that was cool. What the fuck happened though? And while I could talk about the deeper meanings of Identity Crisis, or how Satoshi Kon brilliantly uses the color red to symbolize Mima's descent into madness, you honestly probably don't give a shit, and you just want to know what was real and what was an illusion. I mean, I'm only making this video because I had the same reaction after watching the film, and I needed an explanation to whatever that crazy shit I just witnessed was. I did a ton of research for this video, so if you could, I would greatly appreciate a like, and if not, I hope you get a screwdriver to the face. I'm joking, obviously. I just appreciate people watching my videos, and I hope this clears up any confusion you may have had after watching this movie.
Stop fooling around.
All right.
Our main protagonist, Mima, begins the film as a member of the J-pop trio Cham. Soon after the introduction of Cham, however, we are told that Mima plans on leaving the group to pursue a career in acting, a decision which Mima's manager and former pop idol, Rumi, protests, claiming she's protecting Mima from being tainted by those in the film industry. The truth is, Rumi deeply misses being a pop star herself and has begun reliving her glory days as an idol vicariously through Mima. As Mima chooses to transition careers and become an actress, Rumi snaps and begins to suffer from dissociative identity disorder, believing she is the real Mima, a version of Mima which never chose to leave pop group Cham and has yet to be degraded by the film industry. It's through this real Mima persona that Rumi begins an internet blog known as Mima's Room, where she poses as Mima and regularly updates the site with posts in very specific detail about what Mima did that day, causing Mima to become paranoid. It's through Mima's Room that Rumi begins communicating with Mimania, who is quite literally a Mima stan. I'm talking Dream or BTS level stan here, because Mimania is fucking crazy about Mima, and works with Rumi in trying to prevent Mima from beginning her acting career. Mimania faxes a creepy ass letter to Mima, as well as sends Mima a letter bomb, and just to top off Mima's paranoia, Mimania runs over a heckler from a previous Cham show. As a result of the constant stress of filming Double Bind, her lingering remorse over leaving Cham, her fear of being stalked, her growing fascination with Mima's room, and filming a rape scene, Mima is traumatized and develops psychosis. Mima begins to hallucinate an idol version of herself, similar to the Mima Rumi portrays herself as, a Mima untouched by the film industry. This hallucination mocks and ridicules Mima for being impure, driving Mima to insanity until she loses track of reality. Holy shit, that was a lot to cover. Now we can finally get to the confusing parts. Mima enters her room and hallucinates that her fish have died. This is because off-screen, Rumi broke in and stole Mima's fish for her own version of Mima's room. Like, the actual room, not the website. Rumi then kills the writer who wrote the rape scene in Double Bind, in what is quite possibly one of the creepiest scenes in anime history. That's right, Rumi killed the guy in the elevator, despite Kon originally tricking us to believe Mimania had been committing the murders. Mima takes part in a nude photo shoot which worsens her mental health even further. The photographer goes from super stoked to super dead after he orders a pepperoni pizza with an extra side of screwdriver to the face. At this point in the film, we're supposed to believe it's Mima who's committing these murders in a fit of psychosis, but surprise surprise, it's been Rumi the entire time. Mima finds bloody clothes in her room, which causes her to consider that she is the murderer, though they're actually just from that time she Hulk smashed her tea mug. Then, in a trippy ass scene, we're led to believe that Mima is crazy, but nope, we're just watching the finale of Double Bind. God damn it, this movie is so cool. Mimania then attacks and attempts to rape Mima, but she manages to knock him out with a hammer at the last minute. Mima then draws a parallel to a scene from Double Bind where her character killed someone in that exact spot, adding to Mima's blur between reality and fiction. As Mima is being attacked by Mimania, Rumi kills Tadakoro, Mima's agent and the man who convinced her to transition to an acting career. Rumi then returns and kills Mimania before picking up Mima and driving her back to her home. Only, it's not her home. It's Rumi's home, and it looks almost exactly like Mima's, with only a few inconsistencies. As Mima realizes she's in a fake room, she turns to Rumi, who is now dressed as a pop star under the delusion that she herself is Mima. In an explosive episode of dissociative identity disorder, Rumi chases and attempts to kill Mima. Both are hit by a bus, and then we flash to the present day. Cutting to the present, we see Mima watching a still delusional Rumi through the window of a psych hospital. As Mima leaves the hospital, two nurses she passes argue whether she's the real Mima or a lookalike, to which Mima gives this final and fitting line.
No, I'm the real thing.
But wait, there's more. The quote-unquote Mima, who says the final,
No, I'm the real thing,
was voiced by the same voice actor for Rumi. So, even though there's a lot you can analyze from this film, I think the final takeaway Satoshi Kon would hope for his viewers to feel is a sense of confusion. Confusion similar to that experienced by Mima and Rumi and Mimania and us and every other fucking character in this movie, because this shit was confusing as hell. And I think even deeper, those feelings of unsettling confusion are meant to show us a glimpse of the confusion that must go on in the life of a truly psychotic person, or someone who truly suffers from dissociative identity disorder. In this movie, these mental illnesses are used as a tool to confuse us, giving us a glimpse into the traumatized and confusing minds of the characters in the film. Imagine the confusion the people who suffer from these very real diseases experience. Thankfully, as modern science advances, those who suffer from mental illnesses are granted slightly less confusing lives. Hopefully, and similarly, I've made this film less confusing for you. Maybe you understand it a little more, and your life is a little less confusing. That's my gift from me to you.